July wrap up, but 420. No, it's August. It's August. It's basically the end of the year. Holy shit, this year went fast. Hello everyone, it's your girl Jay, and today I'm here with my August wrap-up for 2020. I read a total of 6 books this month, which is so surprising to me. So without further ado, let us get started. So the first couple of books that I'm going to talk about are the ones that I got from publishers in e-ARC version, because it just makes it easier for editing for me. So the first book that I read is The Kinder Poison by Natalie May, and I gave this a 4 out of 5 stars. So in the land of Orkenna, everybody is born with a magical ability. Zaru is a whisperer, which means she has the ability to talk to animals. Unfortunately for Zaru, this is not exactly a sought after talent, and therefore she does not live a life of luxury. Every 10 years, there's the crossing, which is a competition that the heirs to the throne hold, where they have to cross the desert and kill the human sacrifice to win the throne. Zaru and her friend Hen decide that they're going to sneak into the palace in order to witness the choosing ceremony, which is where the heirs to the throne get to pick who they are going to bring with them on their journey, and that's when Zaru finds herself as the next chosen human sacrifice, and the adventure begins. So this is this author's debut novel, which I would not have suspected based off of the writing style. I was so invested in these characters and their story. This book is definitely character driven. I think that is what made me love this story so much. I had such a soft spot for literally every single character in this book, even the ones who are morally gray and that you're not necessarily supposed to like. I was rooting for all of them and just wanted all of them to be okay in the end, even though it was obvious that that was not going to happen. I also think that the sibling rivalry between the two princes was so interesting and well done. I also really like how there wasn't just the focus on the two brothers, but also the two princes had issues with the sister as well. I think that the family dynamics overall was just a very key part to the story, and it was really interesting to see how each of the siblings chose how to win their father's approval. I'm not even sure which sibling I rooted for the hardest, because they were each so unique and like had a different reason for needing to root for them. Like Sakira seemed to be the superficial party girl, but then when you got to know more about her character, you could see that she did actually care about the kingdom in a way that you didn't really expect. Casta was probably the most intriguing to me. I think that his backstory was the most interesting, and like I want to root for him, but he's also like the most morally gray out of all three of them. And then Jet was the one who I wanted to win the crown. I just have a huge soft spot for him. I really like him, and I'm very interested to see where the second story in the series takes him. And then Zaru, our little main character, I definitely loved her the most. I thought her humor was hilarious. She had a great wit and sense of humor throughout the entire journey, because if I were her, I would not have been that optimistic. I also think that she just grew so much as the story progressed, and I'm definitely intrigued to see where she goes in the next book as well. There was also a little bit of a love triangle between Casta, Jet, and Zaru, which I'm usually not the biggest fan of love triangles, but I was honestly here for this one. I also was a huge fan of Maya, who was like the demon shapeshifter. She had like a side story, and I was so intrigued by it. I am definitely hoping that we get more of her in the next book. I'm like hoping and praying, but like I said, I just need the next book in my life like now. So 4 out of 5 stars, and I definitely recommend you guys check it out if you're into like fantasy books. The next book I read, I listened to on audiobook, and it was Burn Our Bodies Down by Rory Power. I gave it a 3 out of 5 stars. So this book follows Margot, who lives with her mother. They have a very dysfunctional relationship where they rely very heavily on each other. So when Margot starts asking her mother about her extended family, she refuses to give her any information, and then she begins finding some clues about her grandmother, who lives in a faraway town called Faelene. So Margot decides that she is going to go to Faelene to find her grandmother. She arrives there, and she quickly discovers that the town is not the biggest fan of Vera, and that her grandmother is hiding a lot of secrets as well, and it's like the story of that. Honestly, for most of this book, I was just very confused about where it was going and what was even going on in the first place. I never really felt connected to any of the characters, so I didn't really care what happened to Margot as the story progressed. I did really like the exploration of Josephine and Margot's toxic relationship, which also brought the grandmother into it. But other than that, like, I honestly wasn't really that invested in the story. I thought it was very interesting to see the way that Josephine exhibited a lot of the traits that her mother did as well. I also think that the ending was a bit unsatisfactory and I just wanted more from it. So yeah, 3 out of 5 stars. And then the final ebook that I picked up this month was My Eyes Are Up Here by Laura Zimmerman, which I gave a 3.5 out of 5 stars. So this book follows 15-year-old Greer, who is a sophomore in high school. She is just trying to navigate life, but she is very self-conscious about her size 30H boobs. And then a boy named Jackson steps into her life and she needs to navigate her growing feelings for him, as well as her discomfort with her body and the way that people view her, and it's like the story of that. I really liked Greer as a main character. I thought that she was just a ginormous dork and very relatable for people her age. I thoroughly enjoyed reading about her. I think that her sense of humor was really fun, and I really liked watching her grow and become more comfortable with who she is and how she looks and the way people view her as the story progressed. I think that the biggest highlight for this book, in my opinion, was the female friendships. I think that Jessa and Maggie were just such great additions to the story, and it was great to see them stick up for each other and have their backs to the end. I also really liked how the romance aspect of Jackson and Greer's relationship was not the main focus of the book, and it was more of a focus on Greer and her feelings towards herself rather than towards Jackson. I also was a big fan of the volleyball team dynamics of this book. I grew up playing team sports, so just being able to see such a positive thing in Greer's life was really great because it reminded me of what basketball did for me. So I don't really know if everybody will feel that way about the team dynamics, but I was a big fan. But overall, I think that it was like a super cute, really quick read. So 3.5 out of 5 stars. And now on to the physical books I can actually hold up for you guys. The first one is I Know You Know by Jilly McMillan. I gave this a 3 out of 5 stars. This follows Cody Swift, whose best friends Charlie and Scott were murdered 20 years ago down by the local dog park. A young man has already been arrested for the crime, but Cody is not convinced that he is the one who committed it. So he decides that he is going to start a podcast in order to dig a little bit deeper into what happened to his friends. That's when a body is discovered in the same location that the boys' bodies were discovered so many years ago. The original detective on the case, John Fletcher, begins to find links between the two cases, and he starts his own investigation between the two. I really liked the format and the way that this book was laid out. There's chapters from the reopening of the case, chapters with flashbacks from 20 years ago following Jessica, one of the mothers of the boys that was murdered, and then also some chapters of the actual podcast. And I just thought it was like a cool addition to have all of those put into the book. I listened to this book on audio, which I think everybody should do because you actually got the full experience of the podcast that way. I think that it was really interesting to see the case from multiple different viewpoints, but overall I think that it was a bit underdeveloped and a bit unsatisfactory just because there was so much buildup for a very mediocre reveal in the end. The whole wrap-up of the case and what happened to the boys just kind of sucked, in my opinion. Like, it was kind of dumb the way that it ended, and I don't really think that it brought anything new to the genre, although I did have a good time reading it. But like I said, like, 3 out of 5 stars, very mediocre. The next book I have, I gave a 2.5 out of 5 stars. I was not the biggest fan of it, but it is Firstborn by Laurie Anne Grover. This book follows Teodone, who is born into a society where females are not wanted, so she is declared male at birth. This means that she is given an amulet where it is supposed to suppress her female tendencies and have her grow up as males do. As Teodone grows up, she is sent to a camp where she bonds with Arapian. She starts to struggle with her femininity and her growing feelings for her childhood friend, and is basically the story of that. Like I said, I was not the biggest fan of this book. I did not care for Teodone or what she was going through. The pacing was really weird. The writing style just was not for me. My favorite part of the book was Mirko, which is a bird, so I mean, take that as you will. Mirko didn't even talk. So, I mean, that kind of tells you my feelings on the book. I just didn't care, and I think that it could have been done a lot better for the themes that they were trying to get across. but I was not a fan. The final book that I read this month was The Times I Knew I Was Gay by Eleanor Cruz. This is a graphic memoir about Eleanor Cruz from childhood to adulthood, where she is struggling to come to terms with her sexuality. It also discusses other topics such as eating disorders and just self-confidence in general. I ended up giving this a 4 out of 5 stars. I actually really enjoyed it. I actually really liked the art style in this because a lot of the times there wasn't really a format. Like sometimes there's just one picture on the page, but then other times you get like a bunch of pictures. I don't want to like go too far into the story because then it kind of like gives it away, but it was very simplistic, which I think really brought home the whole point of the story. I was a big fan of how supportive a lot of the characters in Ellie's life were. Like her family, she was very nervous to come out to, but everything went very smoothly for her, which I know that a lot of people do not have, so it was nice to see a positive coming out story. I think that a lot of people are going to be able to relate to Eleanor and the way that she had to come to terms with herself and how she felt about other women. And I think that is definitely going to help a lot of people who are struggling with that identity. But yeah, I was a fan. I thought it was cute. It was a good time. So 4 out of 5 stars. All right, everybody. So that was my August wrap up for 2020. I read a total of 6 books. Let me know down below if you have read any of these books and what you thought of them. And I will see you all in my next video. Goodbye.